Now we'll solve an extension of the previous problem. Let us say I have a beaker here and that beaker is moving towards the right with an acceleration of A naught. And you'll actually, if you do this experiment, you'll actually see that the water, is at an angle, right? It does not be straight. So how do I solve this problem? I look at a small strip here, a cylindrical strip, right? And let's look at a point A here and a point B here. Now, let's say the separation here is equal to L, the height here is equal to H1, and the height here is equal to H2. Now, we'll use the same technique which we used in the previous problem, that is to draw free body diagram and then come out with the calculations. We just equate net force is equal to mass into acceleration. Now, the net force on this cylinder in the y direction is equal to 0, and your net acceleration is also 0 because this body, this cylinder here, is only accelerating towards the right. So let's look at the free body diagram of this cylinder. So if this area is equal to A, the area of this cylinder, right, the circular part. So if the pressure at A is PA, so the force here will be PA into the area. Let's call it P1 and let's call this P2. P2 into area here, that will be the pressure in this direction. Now your net pressure, let's take both the pressures in the same direction. Your net pressure, because our equations will tell us whether P is positive or negative. Your net force P2 minus P1 into area should be equal to mass of this column into A naught. Equation number one. Equation number two, if I do the similar analysis like how we did in the previous video, if my pressure here is P naught, my pressure at A, which is P1, P1 should be equal to P naught plus rho g h1, and my P2 should be equal to P naught plus rho g h2. Why I'm in similar analysis, right? Take a small strip like this. Now, the pressure here will be equal to P0 into the area of this small strip. Now, the pressure here is P1 into area of this small strip. But the net force, both forces here should cancel out. And there will also be a force due to gravity. That is the mass into gravity. But the total mass will be basically equal to density into the area into the height. So I'll get P1 A minus P0 A is equal to rho A H G. I cancel A on both sides, I'll get P1 minus P0 is equal to rho G H. So simple stuff, right? So you get P1 is equal to P0 plus rho G H1 and P2 is equal to P0 plus rho G H2. Now I plug this in here. So I'll get P2 minus P1, right? So P0, P0 will get cancelled. If I do P2 minus P1 is equal to rho G into H2 minus H1. So P2 minus P1 into area is equal to mass into A0. But what is the mass of the strip? It will be equal to rho into this area A into that length L. So you will get AA cancel. This area into this length, right, volume of this cylinder. So you will get P2 minus P1 is equal to rho L A0, right? And this is very similar to rho GH. L is in place of H and A0 is in place of G. So the dimensions of both are equal. Now what is P2 minus P1? So you will get rho G H2 minus H1 is equal to L A0. So now rho and rho cancel. So you will get G by A0 is equal to L by H1 minus H2. Now let's look at this triangle. If this height, this triangle actually, this height will be equal to H1 minus H2 and this is equal to L. So if this angle is theta, tan theta is equal to H1 minus H2 by L. So I will be getting tan theta is equal to A0 by g. So this is how, by writing two equations, we are actually able to find out the angle at which this column should actually, the angle at which this column should actually get formed. Now, I'm sure you'll find these calculations in any textbook. But what I essentially wanted to explain you guys is, in fluid mechanics, what we're doing is we're taking a small strip, like you can see a small cylinder, and we're writing down the free body diagrams of the strip. So if I look at the strip here, there is some pressure here and there's some pressure here. So I want to see how the pressure is varying across x. So let me call this P1 and let me call this P2. So I know there's P1 into the cross-sectional area, which is the force here, P2 into cross-sectional area, which is the force there. So how are we calculating force? We're just leveraging the fact that force is equal to pressure into area, right? Simple stuff. There's nothing to get confused here. Pressure into area is the force here. Pressure into area is the force here. See, basically, see, we are comfortable with the idea of force. In the previous chapter, we learnt how to find the acceleration of a body or how to predict the motion of a body if we know force. But in fluids, it's more convenient to work with pressure, because the force exerted will actually increase if the volume of the liquid, if the area is more, and the force decreases if the area is less. Now, how can you think of it? Let's say I have a tank full of water and I have a magical way of breaking just a tiny piece of that tank, and I ask you to hold that piece intact. If I give you smaller area, would it be easier to hold? Or if I give you greater area, would it be easier to hold? Your intuition tells you that if it's a greater area, it would be more difficult to hold, because see, the pressure will be the same, just that when the area increases, the force acting on you will be higher. So in case I give you a larger lid, you'll find it more difficult to hold the water. Or it's something like when you're moving on your scooter, if you were to hold a thermocol sheet, you will find it really hard to resist the air, because the area of cross section increases, so there's more air hitting the thermocol, so there's more force acting on you, right? So it's something like that. So we're now working with the concept of pressure in the context of liquids, because pressure is easier to understand, because pressure kind of remains same. It's the force which varies based on the area. But okay, so we need to use pressure here. But funda hai ki we understand forces better because we learned forces first. So we need to change between force mechanism to pressure mechanism. So we play around with both. How do we play around with both? If my pressure at point A is PA, I find out the force by multiplying PA with the area A, and I find out the force at B by PB into the area at B. So I think one concept is clear, ki we are playing around between pressure and area. We are using them interchangeably based on our convenience. And second thing is, by using Newton's third law, all the internal forces of the molecules inside cancel out. So only three forces remain. One force which is acting at this edge, one force which is acting at this edge, and acceleration due to gravity. In fact, only the pressure at the edges and the force due to gravity, these are the only forces which are remaining, because at the edge there is no other force to cancel this force. But inside, if you look at all the internal forces, the force exerted by this molecule on this molecule, you'll find an opposite force by this molecule on this molecule. So these two forces cancel due to Newton's third law. So the only forces which you should bother about are the forces at the edge of the column and the force due to gravity. So we are worrying about PA and PB in the x direction. PA minus PB into area is equal to mass into acceleration. Your mass is m into a naught, and we substituted mass is equal to density into volume. Your volume is your area into the length cylinder, right? And density is rho. So we got one equation that way, and one more equation by taking a vertical strip. We got that P naught plus rho g h is equal to PA. I mean, same funda, right? We are worried about the net force in the y direction, and we know the net force in the y direction should be equal to zero, because there's no net acceleration in the y direction. Same way, we got PB is equal to P naught plus rho g h2. So we essentially use free body diagram, and we equated net force is equal to mass into acceleration, and we basically leverage Newton's third law by saying that all the internal forces cancel out. So the only forces which you should worry about are the forces at the periphery. So again, I repeat,
the funda here is very simple, right? Once you understand the fundamentals here, it's just the mathematics which you guys will have to calculate. The fundamental here are two things. One, pressure into area is your force. As long as the pressure is constant over a certain area, pressure into that area would be force. And the second part is that the internal forces cancel out. So you'll only be worried about force on the edge of the liquid, and you'll be worried about any other external force like gravity, because the internal forces between molecules cancel out. So through that we wrote the equations and we were able to calculate the variation of pressure over x and over y. In the case of y, we took a small strip and we realized that all the other internal forces cancel out. So there's one force on this edge here and there's one force on this edge here, and the strip is so very small that in this small strip your pressure is not varying across x or across y, right? And so this cross-sectional area is so small that across the cross-sectional area your variation among x is ignored. Why? Because if you are parallelly considering the variation across x and across y, the equations would be too confusing. So I mean, that's the whole idea of calculus, right? Your variation is so small that you agree that you assume that your variable is uniform in that small tiny piece. I mean, that's how you define speed in calculus, right? Your time interval is so small that your motion is almost uniform, so you use the same distance by time formula in a tiny time interval t. So just like that, my area here is so small that my variation in pressure is almost zero across x, but my variation across y is significant. So I get p naught a minus p1 a is equal to mass into gravity. So that's a simple equation which I wrote to get that p2 minus p1 is equal to rho g h. You can probably work out the math yourself, but as far as the physics is concerned, it's two simple observations that the internal forces cancel out each other, so the only forces and the periphery remain out, and you write the net force and you equate the net force is equal to total mass into acceleration. You are using Newton's second law and Newton's third law to basically